Today, I shall teach you the open door policy in China introduced by the USA. The open door policy in China, in fact, hailed the principle of perfect competition and free trade in China. But still, we are to see that USA had certain ulterior motive to have a slice over the Chinese melon. And what was the real meaning of the open door policy and what was the background of the open door policy in China would be the topic of our discussion today. Since the days of the Opium War, the Western powers proceeded with the singular aim of opening China. The opening up of China began with the signing of the Treaty of Nanking in 1842. The Convention of Peking, signed in 1860, completed the process and China was turned into a semi-colonial country. The Qing government miserably failed to put up a stiff resistance against Western aggression and eventually they submitted to the pressure of Western imperialism. However, the Qing court, with the intention of refurbish its tarnished image, took certain measures, but all such efforts were exercises in futility. Similarly, the attempt for self-strengthening China was again a failure. China faced a disastrous defeat in the hands of a small power like Japan in the year 1894-95, that is in the First Sino-Japanese War. China had to concede certain unfavorable and humiliating terms and conditions in the Treaty of Shimonoseki signed in 1895. It was a severe blow to the Chinese prestige. The defeat of China in the hands of a small neighbor like Japan thoroughly exposed the Chinese weakness, and the Western imperialists wasted no time in taking advantage of the situation. What did they do? They again tried their best to partition China into their respective spheres of influence. In no time, powers like Britain, Russia, France, Germany, all of them divided China into their respective spheres of influence. But so long, the United States of America, that is the USA, was not very interested in getting a slice over the Chinese melon. But towards the end of the 1890s, there was a change. In fact, even in the 1890s, the Americans boasted of the fact that they did never wage a war against any Asian power and colonize any area of Asia. But certain changes took place during the closing years of the 1890s. Though America did not interfere in the affairs of East Asia, particularly in the affairs of China, the American missionaries and the American traders enjoyed the benefit of the British Free Trade Empire, and their interests had been protected by the British Navy. But the Americans had not to bear the odium or much responsibility for it. But in the 1890s, there was a significant change in the US foreign policy. According to a famous historian, John K. Fairbank, the American people were more susceptible to imperialism or imperialist virus than they liked to think. In fact, in the second half of the 19th century, particularly after the American Civil War, there was a thoroughgoing change in the internal history of the USA. America gradually becoming an industrially advanced country, and towards the end of the 19th century, America was turned into a highly developed industrial country instead of a primarily agricultural country. The American industrialists got interested in getting the external markets for absorbing their industrial products. Moreover, they amassed and accumulated huge amount of capital. So it was natural that the American industrialists were in search for new areas of investment. So, the search for new markets and search for new areas of investment led America to take an aggressive policy towards other countries as well. In 1898, America launched an attack on Spain and waged a war against Spain. And eventually, after defeating Spain, the Americans had occupied two Spanish positions on the Pacific, Philippines, and Guam. Furthermore, the American planters and the American missionaries induced the US government to capture the Hawaiian island in the same year. Then, there was a protest movement that broke out in Philippines against the American troops. When Americans invaded Spain, the Filipinos helped the American troops because they wanted to liberate themselves from the Spanish chain, but they wanted to reject a new master as well. They also did not like the American domination. So there was a resistance and protest movement in Philippines, and the US troops brutally suppressed the movement of the Philippines. Then, again, a new phase in the American history began. Then America turned her eyes towards China and became interested in having a slice of the big Chinese melon. But at that time, that is during the closing years of the 19th century, the United States of America was not that powerful to monopolize the vast and illimitable Chinese market. Moreover, it was equally impossible for the United States of America to turn the Pacific into an American lake. Apart from this, there was a hostile public opinion in America after America's war against Spain, and particularly after the ruthless suppression of the protest of the Filipinos. As the hostile public reaction broke out, the public opinion within the USA went against the US government. Hence, the US government wanted to proceed in a more diplomatic manner, with much care and without haste at all. The first step was the declaration of the open door policy in China in September 1899. The open door policy in China had been declared by American Secretary of State John Hay. As it was declared by John Hay, it has been termed by the historians as the Hay Doctrine, and this was the introduction of the open door policy in China.
How was China partitioned into several spheres of influence during the period?
China had been divided into spheres of influence since the days of the Opium Wars, but after China's defeat in Japan, particularly Britain, Russia, Germany, and France, they became very much aggressive. For example, Japan took the death of a missionary as a pretext and waged a war against China and said that these areas are mine. Russia took away Mongolia, Manchuria, port of Sakhalin, port Dairen, etc. And nobody was there to protest. And they themselves made their own arrangement. The Western imperialist powers, particularly the European imperialist powers, they made their own arrangement in China. The Qing court, the Qing government was at bay. It had nothing to say. So I told that China was already turned into a semi-colonial country, and towards the end of the 19th century, there were several spheres of influence, some by Germany, some area by England, some area by Russia, some by France. Their own law continued, their own tariff system continued, and they dominated and occupied China, but though there was an independent Chinese government. And in this regard, there was some difference between India and China in this regard. India was the colony of a British power alone, and there was no government, Indian government. First time, English East India Company governed India. Then after 1857, India came directly under the British crown. But this was not the point as far as China was concerned. There was a Chinese government. the Qing rulers, the Qing dynasty would rule China. But there were several spheres of influence. Russia said, this is my land, here my law would continue. Britain said, this is my area, here my law would continue. Thus, which has been called by the historians as cutting of the Chinese melon. They cut Chinese melon and took the slice as they liked. This was the very blatant exposure of imperialism in China in the later part of the 19th century.
Countries who were trying to have their own influence on the Chinese part, were they all alone or there were some kind of alliance between them?
When they fought against China, they had made a makeshift alliance among themselves. But the principal guiding force of the alliance was their own interest. When the interest among them clashed, among the imperialists clashed, one was hostile to the other. For example, when Japan defeated China, Japan wanted some areas, Port Arthur and Darien. Russia opposed it. Then Russia took it, then Great Britain opposed Russia. When it was, China was the common enemy, then they had some understanding. I shall not use the term alliance. But when their interest dominated, the understanding would fade away and they would at loggerheads with each other. Because all of them were imperialist powers and self-seeking powers. They wanted to loot the Chinese wealth. Only one thing they had in their mind. So, we have seen that John Hay, the US Secretary of State, declared the open door policy in September 1899. Though the open door policy had been introduced by the USA, it has been argued by a group of historians that the real innovator of the open door principle was not the USA, was in fact Great Britain. Great Britain from the very beginning was very much apprehensive of the fact that the partition of China into several spheres of influence might hamper her free trade interest on the basis of perfect competition. Being the industrially most advanced country, Great Britain understood that, realized that it would be inimical to her commercial interest if the other powers in their respective spheres of influence would deter Britain to make any free trade. It was the apprehension and fear of Great Britain from the very beginning. So Great Britain did not want that China should be partitioned in the spheres of influence of several powers. But the reality said the opposite. It was not possible for Britain to monopolize everything. The other powers were very much active there. Particularly, Britain was very much apprehensive of Tsarist Russia. Russia made Manchuria their own colony. Russia was very much active in Mongolia. And Russia disturbed the British free trade like anything. So, from the very beginning, Great Britain had the apprehension that her free trade on the basis of perfect competition might be hampered in the spheres of influence of the other powers. But the partition was on the anvil. Partition was imperative. It was not possible for Great Britain to avoid partition under any circumstances. So Great Britain had no other alternative but to turn to America. Sir Julian Ponsford, a British minister in Washington, sent two notes to the State Department of the United States of America. In the note, Ponsford emphasized that a joint declaration of free commercial opportunity should be endorsed jointly by Britain and the USA. But he was not successful. In fact, John Sherman, then the US Secretary of State, was reluctant to accept the British proposal. But British still did not give up the idea. They still thrived on the idea of open door, that China should be an open door country where every country should be able to be allowed free trade on the basis of perfect competition. Another British official and a very high customs official in China, Hippisley impressed upon his American friend Rockhill in this record. He impressed the idea upon Rockhill and gave a memorandum to Rockhill. At that time, Rockhill was the advisor to the Secretary of State John Hay on Far Eastern affairs. And it should be noted that by this time, John Sherman resigned from the post of the U.S. Secretary of State and John Hay became the new U.S. Secretary of State. On the basis of the Hippisley Memorandum, a memorandum had been prepared, a new note had been prepared, and it was submitted to John Hay. And John Hay then declared the open door policy, and not only declared the open door policy, he delivered the note to the countries like Britain, France, Russia, Italy, and Japan. Almost all the countries, after few hesitation, accepted it, that everybody would be able to have the right of free trade and equal commercial opportunity throughout China. What was there in the Hay Doctrine? What was the essence of the open door policy? The open door policy essentially emphasized on three major points had been emphasized. One, no foreign interference with local administration in the spheres of influence would be allowed. Two, in the open ports, the Customs Department of China would collect the tariff according to agreement, and there should be no foreign intervention. And number three, no foreign power would impose any discriminatory tariff on the commercial goods of other countries in their respective spheres of influence. These were the three major points that was emphasized and categorized in the Hay Doctrine, that is in the open door policy, that if this was the sphere of influence of Russia, Russia would not disturb the local administration of China, and Russia should not impose any discriminatory tariff on the British and American goods, as British and America was economically more solid than Russia. They were afraid of the fact if they were given a discriminatory attitude, particularly on the imposition or levying tariff, it would be difficult for them to have a free commercial opportunity throughout China, in the vast market of China. And in fact, this was the essence of the open door policy. One should not think that by introducing open door policy, America was opposed to the idea of aggression in China. It was not the fact. In fact, through the open door policy, the spheres of influence and the encroachment upon the Chinese sovereignty was never questioned. It was accepted that there would remain the spheres of influence and encroachment of Chinese sovereignty would not be condemned. And there was not a single word had been spent regarding this. In fact, the United States of America, in the very closing years of the 19th century, wanted a share in the loot of China. It was the intention of United States of America. Moreover, as the open door policy concerned China, neither United States of America, nor Britain, nor any other European powers took it essential to consult the Chinese authorities. They did not solicit any response from the Qing court. Would the Qing government allow them to have open door in their country or not? It was not the concern of America. It was neither the concern of any other big powers. Moreover, which I have wanted to say, that America wanted a slice in the Chinese melon, and she wanted an entry into China through the dictum of open door through the policy of the open door. When an Elenio Latimore, two famous historians, in their book The Making of Modern China, ironically called the open door policy Me Too policy. Within a few weeks of the declaration of the Hay Doctrine, the Boxer Rebellion had broken out. The Boxer rebels of China unleashed brutal and terrible attack on the foreigners. Christian churches, property of the foreigners, lives of the foreigners were endangered, and there was a ruthless and brutal attack on the foreigners' lives and property in the Boxer Rebellion. The United States of America was apprehensive of the fact that the open door principle might have been violated by other European powers. Then America sent the second note on open door to the other powers on 3rd July 1900. What was there in the second note? In the second note, it was categorically stated that the territorial and administrative integrity and entity of China must be preserved and protected at any cost. But this was meaningless. It was the declaration of America, United States of America alone. America did not take the consent of the other powers like Britain, Russia, France, Germany, so on and so forth. Whether they agreed to maintain the Chinese sovereignty, whether they wanted to maintain and preserve the territorial and administrative entity of China, that was not important for America, and nobody agreed. Nobody disagreed even, because America did not seek their consent. It was the dilemma and dichotomy of the entire thing. So it was meaningless. So it may well be concluded that the open door policy in China was another form of imperialist activity in China. A Chinese historian again very ironically said, "I also want to share the privilege that you enjoy in China." And this was the gist of the open door policy of America in China. So, following the famous sinologist Zhang Sheno, we may argue that the open door policy in China amounted to a mutual guarantee of the foreigners, collective domination over China, and nothing else.
Open door policy is a huge process in the history. But how can you relate such a huge process in history with the whole process of imperialism?
In fact, you know, historians have said that the years between 1870 and 1914 has been termed by the historians as the age of imperialism. And in between that period, the open door policy took place. The open door policy took place in 1899, that is between 1870 and 1914. Why this period is called the age of imperialism? Because we saw that the European powers, particularly the imperialist powers of Europe, at that time were engaged in a race for colonial supremacy in Africa and Asia. And the process began from 1870s, and it reached a new height in the year 1895, and ultimately the colonial race and the race for colonial supremacy led to the First World War also in 1914. So, this period has been called the age of imperialism. What did Lenin say? What did Hobson say? Hobson published a book on imperialism, and the title of the book is Imperialism. It was published in 1908, and Lenin's book Imperialism, The Highest Stage of Capitalism, was published in 1916. The British economist Hobson and Russian theoretician Lenin harped on the same point. They said that when capitalism comes to a very greater stage, the capitalists of several countries, they become interested in three things. They want to enrich their industry by bringing raw material from other countries. So they want to have some grab over the land of others. One point. Secondly, after industrialization is made, they are to sell their industrial products in the external market. They are to grab the external land, land of the other. And third of all, which Lenin said, the age of finance capital, that is the important thing, is that the industrialists, after accumulating huge amount of capital, they go in search for new areas of investment. They want to invest their capital in your own country, in your country as well. These three phases are the phases of high stage of capitalism, which gives rise to imperialism. And if we see the intention of America in declaring the open door policy and support of unstinting support of Great Britain in this regard, what we see? America did not wage a single war against China. Rather, they imposed the principle for having new markets for selling their own goods, for absorbing their own industrial products, and at the same time, the United States of American industrialists were also interested in search for new areas of investment. So it was definitely related to the general history of imperialism. And though general history of imperialism cropped up from the history of Europe, China was in Asia, America was also not in Europe, but still it can well be related with the general history of imperialism. There is no doubt in it.